panel, we have Phil Flynn, Peter Schiff, Gary Kaltbaum, Pat Dorsey, and Bob O'Brien. Phil, first, we've got to start with you, because in the aftermarket session, I'm just looking here, oil is moving higher by about $2.09. What's the latest that you're hearing from the pits?
Well, the latest in the pit that they're very concerned about this storm, and it's almost amazing that we're not even up more. And I think that's the biggest thing most traders are surprised about. I think they're kind of waiting until the last minute to make their bets and place it right ahead of the weekend. But right now, you have to wonder if this market would be higher if it weren't for the storm. It shows you how much the psychology in this market has changed in just a few weeks.
You know, Peter, Phil makes a good point. The psychology of the markets. In other words, yes, a quarter of the U.S. production of oil is in the Gulf, but it's really, I think, you know, when you look at it, the markets need to rally absent a government backstop, absent oil dropping. What else can move the markets higher besides those two issues?
Probably stupidity. I mean, I don't know anybody who can buy in this market is not, you know, doesn't understand the fundamentals, you know. And apart from the oil, if you want to look at the real impact of any potential hurricanes, we don't have any savings to pay for this stuff. So when a hurricane comes through and destroys property, where do we get the money to rebuild it? We have to go deeper into debt. We got to go back to the Saudis and back to the Chinese and borrow even more money. The last thing our economy needs is a natural disaster.
Pat Dorsey, we did get this durable goods number that everybody's talking about. Is this a sign that the economy is doing better than everybody thought yet? I'm just wondering if this isn't a blip on the radar screen. I'd love to see it be a trend as well. However, we're seeing companies hunkering down. They're not doing major cap expenditures, and they're also not hiring that much.
Yeah, I mean, the data is very, very conflicting right now in terms of we get this durable goods number, then we get some bad employment numbers, and the anecdotal evidence on the ground suggests that things really have not sustainably turned for the better. And I think, as with most things right now, it all goes back to the housing market. And until those inventories of existing homes come down and people start seeing a little bit of stability in their home prices, you get that negative wealth effect reversing itself. I don't think we can have a real sustainable rebound in the economy.
You know, but Bob, what Phil is talking about right now, what's going on with Tropical Storm Gustav, there's a 50-50 chance it could be upgraded. How much of this is really, I mean, isn't there always a bull run in hurricane seasons and in oil? And it's really more, could be more of a dollar and demand story?
Yeah, it could be. It's kind of fascinating, though, to finally watch oil, the prices being dictated by that plain old thing. You know, the old saying among oil traders used to be, if you want me to tell you the direction of oil prices, tell me what the weather's going to be like. So it's kind of interesting to see it trading once again on basic fundamentals rather than on whatever drove it from $75 to close to $150. But yeah, you're right. Seasonally, there is this bull move. We're moving towards September, typically the heart of hurricane season. People start discounting the expectation that there is going to be some supply disruption, and that could be taking place. I think Phil makes a good point that it's perhaps a little surprising that we haven't seen a more dramatic reaction here.
Gary Kaltbaum, let's bring it back to the markets overall, and we did have a pretty decent rally today, but you know, Peter Schiff would say that's there's not real foundation built under it that would last.
Well, look at the volume right now. There isn't any. Everybody's on vacation. Today's volume was less than July 2nd, which was a half day in the market. So you just got to keep that in mind. So they're just flipping things around here and there. The major trend remains down. I'm really not seeing, and I need to see powerful action to get me real bullish. There's really not a lot of leadership, nothing busting out to new highs on heavy volume. And I just think, you know, we see these durable good numbers, but it's kind of a volatile number. And I think there was an inflation component that made it look better. I'm not seeing much great in the economy. So I think this is going to take a little bit more time.
So, Gary, just a follow-up quickly. What will make the markets break out? The markets need to rally. Absent a government backstop to Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, absent oil, you know, going down, what can make the market break out absent those two factors?
There is one word that markets always come back to, and that's earnings and the direction of earnings. And earnings are not very powerful right now. You can start with the financials, but retail earnings are pretty flattish to down. Until that changes, markets are going nowhere. Matter of fact, until the market starts picking up, that changes. Markets are going nowhere.
Peter,
you need growing earnings, and right now earnings are stagnant to going south.
Yeah, they're going to go a lot lower. You know, Pat brought up housing, looking for some stability in home prices. We're nowhere near there. You remember, nationally, we still have at least another 15% to 20% to fall in home prices, maybe more.
In
big markets, you know, like California, Florida, probably in this area, the Northeast, we're going a lot lower than that. So we're years away from any kind of stability in home prices.
Pat, do you agree on that?
Less than years.
Less than years.
One of the things, if you believe that today's market rally was in fact leveraged off the durable goods, whatever happened to the notion that it was the consumer that's the engine of our economy, that the consumer is two-thirds? This is a look at what some capital spending on the part of corporate America is doing. They're not affected by the credit crunch, the overwhelming part of our economy. I'd rather listen to what companies are saying now. We heard Darden Restaurants yesterday coming out and saying, guess what? There's no pickup in traffic. We have not seen people coming
back. Great point, Bob. That's the great point. When you get a company like Darden, which is a dominant force in the restaurant industry, and they had to lower their numbers big time, a lot of the other restaurant stocks went along for the ride, and it's indicative of what we're seeing in the economy right now. And if a Darden restaurant isn't, I don't know what is.
And, Phil, you get the 1-2 punch with the high oil prices. Forget it. There goes the consumer.
If you look at the consumer side of the oil market, and that is gasoline demand, it is off the map. I see pain in those gas demand numbers. I see people changing their habits, and there's still more pain to come, I'm afraid.
Especially if Gustav does actually,
get
push
upgraded.
The prices
yeah,
higher.
That's right. Yeah. And also, Phil, just a follow-up question quickly. Gazprom talking about an OPEC, a gas-type OPEC, with Libya and Nigeria. Isn't that also a threat with gas prices?
It is, and you wouldn't believe how much natural gas they control, a huge amount. We talk about switching to natural gas in this country and its ample supply. To be honest with you, if you put those countries together, throw in Iran, they control 70% of the world's natural gas supply. This could be huge. You know, that's why we have to think twice before we talk about T. Boone Pickens' plan to go to natural gas. We may just be exchanging one problem for another.
Right. Be careful what you wish for.
It's true. There's always the balance on there. Thanks, gang. Here's a look at what's still ahead today on Bulls and Bears. Post posted, Robert, let's open it up to the Bulls and Bears. Obviously, a big management shakeup, a surprise that it took this long, Bob O'Brien.
Well, this is horrible. I mean, this is terrible timing. We're right on the cusp of some sort of an announcement. I mean, there was an expectation earlier today the Treasury might have something to say. And the financial architect leads on the cusp of that?
Right.
That's horrible news. I was also surprised in his report to find out Fannie Mae had a risk officer.
I'm shocked.
Exactly. That's a great point because, Peter, Fannie and Freddie were buying subprime securitizations after the housing bubble blew. That's like smoking in bed while your house is on fire. Sure. But do you see this as a preemptive move by Fannie Mae to avoid nationalization? Because in a nationalization, they would kick out management.
Well, I think it's unavoidable because they're talking about $1 trillion at least in losses between Fannie and Freddie. Right now they're still guaranteeing 80% of the new mortgages. These mortgages are all going to go bad, too. Prices are still much too high for real estate. So, there's no way to save them. I wish the government would actually have some backbone and just let them fail and tell the people that hold their bonds and hold the mortgages that they guaranteed that they're just going to have.
But you think they'll let that happen?
No, I hope they'll probably let the shareholders get wiped out. But unfortunately, they're probably going to try to bail out the people holding the paper. And that's unfortunate for everybody, including the people who own the bonds.
Could we bring in our other Bulls and Bears, Bill? Is Pat there? Okay, Pat, do you think the Treasury jumping in here in full fray is far behind this announcement?
I actually am not sure whether they're all that related. I might even take the counterpoint that, getting rid of the CFO might be an attempt to basically get Treasury off their backs and say, hey, listen, we can clean up our own messes. Thank you very much. We'll take care of it. I don't know. This is all kind of reading the tea leaves, right? But I think that any Treasury move depends far more on their capital position than anything that happens with their management, because it's clear that management already has had their finger off the button. I mean, that's obvious, right? So I think it's where the capital position shakes out that is going to determine the need or non-need for Treasury to take action.
Gary Kalbaum, do you think the government steps in before October 1st? We've got $223 billion in debt between the two rolling over imminently. That is a huge amount of money for the credit markets to swallow.
Look, it's not just that. There is just billions and billions and billions of this preferred stuff that's out there that's owned by other banks and funds, and they're all down 50-60%, and there's a worry all that's going to zero. That means more markdowns for the financials. That means more market problems on top of what Fannie Mae has already going for it. Government is going to step in. I am surprised they haven't done it as yet. I don't know what's going to move their hand. Maybe they're waiting to get past the conventions, maybe past the the election, but something definitely ultimately is going to get done. I have no idea which way it goes. And by the way, whoever their risk officer was, I wouldn't be crossing the street with that guy. That's all I got to say.
No, I mean, you know, Michelle Girard, let's bring you in on this to sort of fold in the economic picture here. Everybody talks about Fannie and Freddie. They can't fail. Yeah. You've got to. So now you've got this management shuffleboard
they
game.
They have failed.
I guess I would agree that I don't think that today's announcement and the idea that Treasury may end up ultimately injecting capital are related. Our suspicion here is that the Treasury will ultimately need to step in, only because, you know, when you lay something like that out there, like Treasury Secretary Paulson did, you're foolish to think that the markets aren't going to call your bluff on it. If you lay that out there and think that just because you announce that you have this big gun, you won't have to use it, that you misunderstand these markets. The markets are dying to call your bluff and will ultimately force you to put your money where your mouth is. In terms of the economic impact, the most important thing here is that Fannie and Freddie continue to support the mortgage market by buying these conventional mortgages. Well, because we cannot have a situation where mortgage credit becomes even tighter.
Why?
You're right, because it's already eating into housing demand, and if we have a situation...
But not if housing prices are allowed to fall. Prices go down.
They should be allowed to fall, but if people cannot get credit, they cannot get mortgages.
But they won't need as much credit if the prices collapse.
That's right, but they're still going to need to borrow some amount of money.
But they'll be able to borrow once the prices are low.
Peter, banks are already tightening their purse strings.
Right.
They've suddenly
found
God.
Liz, every house is going to get bought by somebody, all right?
Right,
somebody's
but not for the amount of money that most people have in their bank accounts.
Let the prices tumble by 80 or 90%. People will buy them. Houses
they
are worth what people can afford.
They will, but they're going to have to finance them. I mean, nobody
no,
has.
No, if they fall enough, people can buy them with cash.
Well, I don't anticipate that we're going to have prices falling enough that the majority of people are going to be able to finance it by the cash they have on hand.
Yeah, you know, to echo something that Michelle was talking about, I'm a little surprised that the Treasury has appeared quite so indecisive about exactly what's going on. It seems as though Paulson is hemming and hawing about exactly
what. So you don't buy, as Michelle points out, his bazookanomics theory, that he's got the big gun and the market will calm down.
You know, that works great if you're practicing nuclear diplomacy. It doesn't work as well.
Can I try to say something?
We've got such a big gun back here that we don't
remember.
The problem here is there is just so many moving parts. It is not just the housing. It's all the debt and leverage that's out there. Einstein couldn't figure out how much it is, and I don't think the government has any clue what's going on out there.
You got to remember that the important part about the credit is we don't have any savings, right? These mortgages were being financed by foreigners. So if we're going to have to finance it domestically, we're going to have much lower home prices because we don't have any money to loan people
to buy
homes.
We need to bring out, though, we need to clarify a very important point that Gary Kalbaugh is making, and that is that $36 billion of the preferred shares are held by regional banks across the country. Sovereign Bank is exposed. West America Bank. They put it in their capital cushions. If that gets zeroed out, they not only have to raise more money, possibly ironically through another preferred offering, but also massive write-downs. I think the Fed is worried about cascading effect.
And by the way, what happens, Pat, to the regionals who took that chance and it appears to be a bad bet, a wrong way bet on Fannie and Freddie?
They'll get hurt. And if they're not well capitalized, they'll get hurt even worse.
And who's the buyer of last resort under these circumstances?
It's not catastrophic.
Here's a question for Bob O'Brien. Is the Federal Reserve the asset dump of last resort? Can that balance sheet at the Federal Reserve handle massive bank failures?
Not without more recourse to taxpayer funds, of course.
Well, not taxpayers. It's savers. They destroy our currency. The balance sheet has nothing.
All I would say is that when you talk about the asset dump of last resort, I think the Fed has done as much as they're going to do. If we're going to move these assets into the public arena, it's going to be the Treasury that'll take it on in some form of an RTC type setup. I don't think the Fed is going to be involved in that kind of
Gary
situation.
Gary Kay, what does this announcement about Fannie Mae mean to the average person out there?
Absolutely nothing. You know, I hate using cliches, but this is the Titanic in the deck chairs. New people come in to oversee things. And like I said, it is an absolute mess. This is something that's been talked about for 2 years, and now our government's just trying to get their hands on it. They should have been on it a couple years ago, and now it's past the point. And eventually they're going to be goners in one way, shape, or form.
Let me let Pat get in here, though. You were trying to say, sort of moderate the tone here and say it's not the worst thing in the world.
Well, no, just, I mean, getting back to the preferred stock that's being held on the balance sheets of a lot of banks, certainly the banks that bet too large on that, and no bank should put too much of their assets in any one, in their capital, any one asset, whether it's Fannie Mae preferred or construction loans, they're going to get hit pretty badly. But it's not going to be the hit to the banking system that the poor lending practices were over the past few years.
But,
it's a drop in the bucket
but
compared
Pat
to that.
But the reason why, hang on, the reason why the banks got the preferred shares is because they did not have to pay taxes on the dividend. They got a special exemption from that. Go ahead.
Well, that's correct. I mean, but again, you never want, as a prudent capital allocator, risk manager at a bank, neither whether you get a tax preference or not, you don't want to put too much of your capital in any one asset. And those banks that, you know, took too much advantage of this special tax benefit from Fannie Mae preferreds, they'll get their rear ends handed to them,
right,
as they should.
This is a real softball for Peter, but do you think when Sheila Bair says that IndyMac was one of the biggest banks that'll fail and not to worry, do you believe her?
No, not at all. More banks are going to fail.
Big ones?
Bigger banks are going to fail. And it's unfortunate because people are thinking, well, is my money safe? You know, even if the FDIC bails you out, it's not even going to matter. You know, there's just so much inflation.
And are we really talking about prudent risk officers at you know, regional banks here? These guys did some of the worst management of their asset classes that you can possibly
imagine. All they cared about was market share. It's like everybody else was doing something stupid.
Quickly, Gary.
The FDIC is now talking about borrowing from the Treasury also.
Oh, it is just
an absolute web of nonsense.
It's the tin cup, alms for the poor.
Right.
All right, everybody, much more on that shakeup at Fannie Mae we've been talking about.
Stick with us here on Bulls and Bears. Stay with us. Thank you so much. Okay, Southwest.
Nobody's flying.
Yeah, it's like gearing yourself up for military battles.
That's why Southwest,
you know,
is making this announcement here.
That's right.
Yes, they've been a shining example of how to run a successful airline as others have struggled.
But now it too is feeling the pinch, scratching 6% of flights this winter in an effort to save money. So is this the strongest sign yet that the airline industry is going to need a government bailout? Let's ask our Bulls and Bears panel. First to you, Peter Schiff.
Well, they don't need a government bailout. I mean, the industry is going to contract. We know that. I've been talking about that for a couple of years on these shows. American airline industry is going to have to reinvent itself in light of the fact that the average American is now too broke to afford to fly. And so we're a poorer country than we used to be. Americans are mired in debt. They have no more home equity, so they can't fly. And so the airlines are going to have to get smaller. They're going to have fewer routes, and they're going to have to jack ticket prices way up so they can actually make a profit. And then those Americans that are still rich enough to pay the freight will be able to fly. But we don't need the government to do this. But unfortunately, it's probably going to be accomplished through a lot of bankruptcy reorganizations for a lot of the airlines.
Pat Dorsey, what saves the airlines? Is it government intervention?
It's a smaller airline industry. Anytime you have overcapacity in a commodity industry, prices are too low to sustain profits. The solution is simple. You simply take out capacity. Unfortunately, because airlines are, for, you know, kind of like the automakers, very politically sensitive because they employ a lot of people and people sort of view them as a public service almost. They do have a lot of political clout, and so, you know, there is, I think, a risk that you wind up getting them successfully bidding for government aid, which has kept them on life support for three decades and hasn't really helped the industry one bit.
You know, Bob O'Brien, last quarter, two-thirds of the airline industry's revenues went toward gas and energy prices, jet fuel prices. At what price point does oil have to go to really tank the sector?
Well, you know, if we just go back to $140 a barrel,
is that the threshold amount?
Yeah, at this juncture, you know, the only way you look at that is with a ripe attenuation of exactly how many planes are going to be on the tarmac and in the air. You're going to be talking about a drastically smaller fleet size here. But, you know, there are statistics. I mean, if you look, every time you get a dollar reduction in the cost of a gallon of jet fuel, which we saw from the July highs through, you know, these August lows, that basically translates into about $13 billion for the industry. For the industry overall. That's very helpful. So if we can keep these oil prices down, maybe they can come up with a model. That's a big if.
They should be hedging these prices right now because they're not going to stay
well. And that's why Southwest has had a successful run of things recently.
Most of these airlines are just gambling, and they're not hedging at all.
Gary Kay, what is your thought on this?
Well, first off, Gary Kelly is the CEO of the decade for hedging oil prices over the last few years for Southwest. But look, for me, where there's demand, there'll be supply. They're contracting right now because there's less demand. Southwest is leading that. But in Orlando, for instance, Delta knocked out a bunch of smaller airport direct flights. Southwest came in and took them over. So as long as there's demand, but airlines are doing what they have to do right now. They are getting rid of the routes they cannot make money on based on oil prices. And if oil prices keep coming down, they'll change that. It all depends. Look, it's the biggest expense for them. It's been that way since the day one will continue to be. Oil prices need to come down or nothing good's going to happen for them.
Pat Dorsey, are you optimistic that oil prices will come down?
Further than they have already, maybe a bit, but you know, long run, we're not seeing $50 oil again.
Thanks a lot.
You know,
or they're gonna start charging us for breathing on the airplane. You
know, the airlines weren't even making money at $50 oil. When were they making money?
Yeah, no, they're terrible at this.
I mean, they have other problems.
You know who's really going to get crushed though with these Southwest announcements is casino operators in Vegas, because the bulk of these flights that are being cut are flights that are originating out of Las Vegas. So that, you know,
that
already
really
casino operators are already on
the
heels.
Are they seeing it already happening in Vegas?
Oh, it's become desperate. Yeah. I mean, you can
What about the vacation home market? Another, you know, if you can't get to your vacation house,
yeah,
why do you need it?
Yeah, if you bought one of those properties that's located so, you know, a flight away from Vegas.
On that lovely note,
we are full of good cheer today, isn't it?
That's a cheerful note. Ex-home run king Mark McGwire makes the Hall of Fame, but not
you.
Thank you very much. Once again, Fannie Mae shares halted on news that there would be a management shakeup. We had all kinds of information about that. And, you know, it was just an hour earlier that we had Mickey Levy, who's the chief economist of Bank of America, on Countdown to the Closing Bell. I asked him specifically when Treasury would jump in or whether Treasury would jump in to save this company. Hasn't happened yet, but here's what he had to say. Does Treasury jump in? This is what I've heard. One of these names, Fannie or Freddie, has to get down to $2 a share. Then it'll be so cheap that Treasury can then backstop them and fully save them. Or October 1st, when the housing bill kicks in.
I don't think it's going to be determined by some trigger price of those stocks. To me, it's almost imminent. And Fannie and Freddie have a huge amount of debt rolling over in September. There's this just huge amount of uncertainty. I think the Treasury is moving, very rapidly toward putting together a package, and they're minding all of the details. And I think we're going to see it sooner rather than later.
Do you agree, Pat Dorsey, that Treasury comes in sooner rather than later here?
I just don't know whether... You know, again, it all comes back to the capital ratios. I don't think it's the stock price that matters a whole lot. And, you know, we get new data on the housing market daily, and I honestly don't know one way or the other. But at the end of the day, it's their financial position, not their stock prices, not market sentiment, not who's in the management suite that's going to determine things.
All right, Bob O'Brien, if the government does step in, how will they step in? Will they take, you know, subordinated debt warrants in Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac? Will they do a preferred equity stake in the two? What will the bailout, if it happens, look like?
Well, that's the big question, and this is one of the reasons why I say the Treasury is looking very ineffectual right now, because not only have they not suggested the timing of what they're going to do, they haven't given us any idea of what kind of a box they're going to build here. I mean, the simplest way to do this would be to backstop it, you know, sort of affected with the way that the government bailed out the airlines, or for example, Chrysler back in the 70s, where they effectively just guaranteed the debt, took back some paper from the company, which they subsequently sold at a profit, and use that structure to allow the company to you know, sort of foster growth. But, you know, the one question about the timing here, this may not be up to Treasury, because if these suckers go to zero and they're bankrupt, that's going to force the Treasury's hand.
Peter?
Yeah, well, unfortunately, you know, there's no way that either is going to survive without some type of government help. And I think, unfortunately, the best thing to do is to let them fail. The government is probably not going to do that. They're going to find some way to salvage their functions, whether it's nationalizing the businesses with the hope of maybe one day spinning them off again in a different form. But whatever the government does, they're going to make it worse through the bailout. As bad as it would be to let them go under, that is a preferential
thing. 10 seconds, Gary Kay.
They should take a stake and stick it in their heart and let the private sector take over, just like Warren Buffett did with mortgage insurance recently, because where there's a profit, somebody's going to fill the void.
All right, gang, thank you very much. Still halted, I believe, for
Fannie
Mae.
Thank you, gang.
Here's a look at who made money today. well. So let's ask, as we round out our show, what you need to know. How will the markets react? Bob O'Brien.
I don't think it's going to be positive. I think we've had a three-day running winning streak for Fannie and Freddie. It had to come to an end sometime. I think the market's going to be further confused about what's next. Market obviously doesn't like confusion.
You know, Peter, it looks like the moves being made, there's news crossing the wires right now, that they're doing the restructuring to help bolster its capital positions. What do you make of that?
They have no capital anymore. All they have is liabilities.
Right.
And look at the next one. It's going to be the FDIC, right? Yesterday they announced they're going to have to start tapping the Treasury. They're running out of money. Well, the news is they already have no money. 100% of their reserves right now are already in Treasury.
And Gary Kay, the CEO, survives this at the moment.
With that last name, Mudd, I don't know how, to be honest with you. Look, there's two things here. Massive leverage and a depreciating asset in housing. It is a toxic cocktail for the future. I do not see it changing, and something better be done, or it's going to fall apart at the seams, and I'm very worried about September coming up.
Pat Dorsey, quickly, you agree?
If this is just a management shakeup, it's a complete non-event. If there is, as you just hinted at, something to do with the capital structure and changing the capital cushion, then it could be pretty interesting tomorrow.
All right. Thank you, gang.
Thank
interesting
you so
trading
much.
Tomorrow.
It's been a wild roller coaster ride, but guess what? There is much more to come.
That's right. It's time to get happy.
We have happy hour. This time it's Rebecca and Cheryl live next from the Bull and...